what I was going to ask is how you, you know, you've taken a very incremental approach to change over your tenure as prime minister, and how far can the system be pushed, especially when it comes to the economy?
Right.
It seems like there's fairly broad scale recognition across the Israeli public that the left wing was just wrong for 20 years.
That I think is, I actually think that is one of true achievements that I've had, because I've changed their mindset.
I mean, the hard left, doesn't exist anymore. I mean, it's extraordinarily...
Right. Try that on the rest of the Western world.
but there's still constraints given
about
the
fact socialist
that,
America?
Exactly. How about that?
Well, there are still constraints as far as the coalitional system, meaning, there are a lot of parties that require heavy welfare spending, for example. Right. And if you're a leader who wants to minimize the fat man, how do you achieve that, given the fact that the majorities are so slim and it's so difficult to keep a coalition?
You constantly have to make coalitions, even when you have a coalition, all the time. But I think you asked a question: how do you know mm-hmm. what to do? And I, you know, what do you need to know as a leader? Okay. And I asked that my father. I asked that of my father before I became prime minister. I said, well, what do you think is the most important requirement for the prime minister of Israel? And he said, what do you think? And I said, I think you have to have a vision. Mm-hmm. And I think you have to have the both the persistence to pursue it, but also the flexibility to navigate as you...
That's some play in the system.
Right. And he said, well, that's true of anything. It's true of a university dean. It's true of a business leader. It's true of
family,
a military commander. So I said, all right, so what is it, the peculiar thing that you need to be the prime minister of Israel? And he answered me with one word, which absolutely startled me. He said, education. You need a very broad and deep education, otherwise you'll be at the mercy of your clerks.
Right.
So you have to have a grounding in history and economics and in military matters and in the main areas that determine the life of a state. You obviously can't know everything, and you have to know how to tap into people, but you won't know how to tap into people, neither will you know what are the crucial things and what are the unimportant things if you don't have a deep and broad education. And I think he's absolutely right.
So when you were making these micro coalitions that were necessary to move your platform forward, how much of your ability to do that was tied to your capacity to listen? Because you said you have to make coalitions, right? So you have to get to know people. You have to bring them on board. And the great leaders that I've known a couple, were always listening to their constituents. And they would aggregate their concerns. And then even as local politicians, in some sense, who are going door to door, one of the things that draws people to successful candidates is just the ability of the candidate to allow the person who's speaking to just say what the problem is, independent of whether the candidate can formulate a solution. But it's that willingness to listen, and then of course you know what people's concerns are. But it's also, I've observed anyways, that if you want to bring people along for the ride, well, maybe you have to jointly decide where you're going, but listening is an excellent way of doing that.
I think it's indispensable, because first of all, you may have a conceptual framework of what needs to be done, but first of all, you might be wrong in a few things. Secondly, you might want to tailor what you want to achieve based on what... You can't be too far ahead of the curve.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot be.
Mm-hmm.
So because what you can see maybe 10 years from now doesn't mean that people can see that.
Yeah. It's a problem with product development, too. You don't want to be too far ahead.
You can't be too far ahead, number one. Number two, I would say it's not only the public that you should listen to, the voters, but in a system of proportional representation where you're basically working with a very small group of parliamentarians, you have to listen to them, and you shouldn't fake that you're listening. Mm-hmm. I think you wrote about that. You shouldn't fake that you're listening. You should actually listen to them. Because it took me a while, by the way. My wife, who's a psychologist, taught me that. I said, no, listen to them. Listen.
Yeah. Well, people will tell you what they think if you listen.
And first of all, they're not everybody. They're not all stupid. Mm-hmm. And most of them are quite smart. Mm-hmm. A, they wouldn't be there if they were... They wouldn't last if they were stupid. In Israeli politics, you don't last very long. So maybe you learn something. Mm-hmm. Also, you learn about what motivates, what are their dreams, their anxieties, their passions, their jealousies. Mm-hmm. When I shrank, after I did these economic reforms, I was brought down to 12 seats, I would hold weekly meetings with this reduced faction, a dozen people. And in a big group or in a little group, you have the same jealousies and same thing. And so every time we'd finish the meeting, one of the parliament members of the faction would come to me and say, did you hear what he said? You know, he's speaking from position. The same guy, the other guy would say the same thing about the others. And I said, well, don't we all? But if you listen to all of them, maybe you'd get the right position, and that is something that I learned over time. I wouldn't say that I understood it right away. It took me a while.
And how did your wife know it?
Because she has an EQ of 100,000. Mm-hmm.
And she practices as a
therapist. She's a child psychologist.
Uh-huh. So she spends her time listening. That's about 90% of what a good psychologist does.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Because it's amazing what people will tell you if you listen.
That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. So the problem is how to slice up your time. That's another problem. Mm-hmm. But I think my father's advice. I had a visit from Dan Rather, whom I knew when I spent my time as a diplomat in the United States. So he came to see me, came to Israel with his grandson, who was going to Brown University. And the grandson wanted to go into politics and he wanted to ask my advice. What should he study? And I said, you should study three things. History, history, and history. Mm-hmm. Okay, history, history, and history. You would add psychology, psychology, and psychology. But history incorporates that, if you read it carefully. And I truly believe that unless you have a historical perspective, you really cannot see, if you can't see how you got here, how do you know where to go?
Right.
If you can't understand what's happening in front of your face, how can you chart the future?
Well, you have nothing to judge it against either, and you have no context of evaluation. So you said three things for leadership then. So one was to make sure that people survive. One was to get obstacles the hell out of the way of competent people. And the third is to develop some sort of contextual interpretive framework that's history-based.
Well, I think for me in Israel, it's even simpler than that. It's not simpler, but it all comes out to something, and that's to create what I call the Iron Triangle of Peace. Because if you have economic power on you, then you can fund your military power. The two of them will create political power, diplomatic power, mm-hmm. because nations will come to you as opposed to you coming to them.
Right.
They want your cyber thing, they want your anti-terror thing, they want your civilian technology, water.